let me briefly say what happens in the process of infection. So when an infectious agent enters our body, it first encounters certain physical barriers in the skin, for example, and these and even within the body, it encounters certain kinds of cells of the immune system, which constitute the innate immune system. So these are not specific for a particular pathogen, but they recognize certain conserved molecular features present on pathogens. Now, if the pathogens are able to escape the innate immune system, then the adaptive immune system comes into play. And this consists primarily of B lymphocytes, which produce molecules called antibodies, and T lymphocytes, which enhance the production of antibodies and also through production of these effector T cells. Now, what antibodies do is to bind to specific molecules, typically on the surface of the pathogen, and they prevent the pathogen then from infecting target cells. And these kind of antibodies are called neutralizing antibodies. Antibodies also bind to the pathogen proteins expressed on the surface of the infected cells and then target those cells for destruction. Similarly, the T cells help in generation of antibodies, and there's a certain kind of T cells which recognize and destroy infected cells, and they recognize these infected cells by fragments of the foreign proteins which are expressed on the cell surface. So the body's adaptive immune system can learn to recognize new pathogens, and this happens through T cells, which then enable various other immune responses, and B cells, which take the help of T cells to proliferate, and then they make antibodies that target the virus for destruction by binding to these molecules on the surface of the virus. Now, in addition to directly acting on the infecting pathogen, the adaptive immune system also produces long-lived memory and B and T cells that can recognize the virus and protect the body for many months or years. And this is an important component of vaccines, because when we vaccinate, we want immune memory to be created so that the next time the pathogen comes in addition to the existing antibodies, these memory B cells can rapidly produce fresh antibodies. So there are different kinds of vaccines. They now this is a bit of an old slide. So now we have the mRNA vaccines, which have been approved for human use. And what the RNA vaccines do is RNA is typically encased in a lipid and injected into a body. So then it enters the cells. And then the RNA is recognized by the cellular machinery, and it produces viral proteins, which are then exported and recognized by the immune system. It can also produce some viral proteins inside the cell, which then can get degraded and also trigger T cell responses. Similarly, there are viral vector vaccines, which can go inside cells and then allow the proteins encoded in the vector to be made. And these can be replicating vectors as well as non-replicating vectors. So the Chadox vaccine, the AstraZeneca Oxford vaccine, which is made by Serum Institute of India in India, this is an example of a non-replicating viral vector vaccine. So, and then we have actual virus instead of viral vectors. This can be either inactivated virus, which is what the Bharat Biotech COVID-19 vaccine is, or it can be live attenuated virus, for which we don't currently have a licensed version for COVID-19. Next, we can have protein subunit-based vaccines. And these vaccines consist of a purified protein from the virus, which is then again recognized by the immune system, and the body produces antibodies, which can then react with the corresponding protein in the virus. And this requires typically a molecule called an adjuvant, which stimulates the immune system to make the antibodies. So there are many different vaccines which are available today. The bulk of vaccines, especially in India, are given to children. Okay, there are almost no adult vaccines except the pneumococcal vaccine, which has quite restricted use in India. But now, of course, with COVID-19, we are going to have a very large adult vaccination program with COVID-19. So there are several under development, the existing ones which have been approved also for use. And then these are very important viral and parasitic diseases for which we don't really have a good vaccine. So the steps in making a vaccine are, first of all, the basic lab research, then the preclinical studies in small animals or primates, and then the clinical studies, which consist first of safety studies, and then a larger, what is called a phase 3 trial, which can do give information about the efficacy of a vaccine. So you can see the conventional timelines are close to 10 years from the initial discovery research. But now with COVID-19, this whole process has been accelerated. So within a year from discovery of the pathogen, we actually have vaccines which are licensed for emergency use. Okay, so the now the spike glycoprotein is a major protein that's on the surface. It's these green things sticking out of the surface of the coronavirus. And so most of vaccine efforts are focused on eliciting protective antibodies which bind to the spike protein. Because if you have antibodies which bind to the spike and which prevent viral entry into cells, then obviously you will prevent infection. So how does the virus infect cells? In the particular case of the SARS-CoV-2 virus, which is the causative agent of COVID-19, there's a molecule, a receptor molecule called ACE2. And what the spike protein does is to bind to this receptor. And then that initial binding event triggers a series of downstream events which lead to fusion of the host and viral membranes and entry of the virus into the cell, where then its nucleic acids are replicate and get translated and so on and so forth. Okay, but the initial step involves the recognition of the spike protein by the ACE2 receptor. So obviously, if we have antibodies that bind to the spike protein in the receptor binding site and prevent this interaction, then the virus will not be able to infect. So these are the approved COVID vaccines. They're a total, you don't need to look at the details here in the small print. But in summary, there are 11 vaccines in total that have been approved as of February 18th. Two of these are mRNA vaccines. Okay. Three are non-replicating viral vectors like the Covishield, the Chadox vaccine. Five are inactivated virus like the Bharat Biotech virus, and there's one peptide vaccine. So in India, close to 12 million people have received at least one dose of the vaccine after 40 days of the program. But of course, we still have, this is a very small fraction of our total population. But expectedly, this rate will certainly increase as days go by. So these are just for information, the different developers, the different kinds of vaccines, and the regions of the world where they have been approved. And in India, we have the two approved vaccines currently, which is the Covaxin from Bharat Biotech and the Covishield vaccine. Okay, so now all of these, of course, the approved vaccines have gone through some degree of clinical trials. And this is a summary of the existing available data. Now, as I said, the most important kind of correlate, there isn't a, so we don't exactly know what property of the vaccine response actually correlates with protection. But it's very likely that neutralizing antibodies from animal studies and from experience with other vaccines, the neutralizing antibodies are very, very likely to be what's called a correlate of protection. So in other words, if we can measure how much neutralizing antibody is produced, which is able to prevent viral infection in cell culture, that gives us an indication of how good the vaccine might be. And higher neutralizing antibody titers are associated with higher protection. So far, the neutralizing antibody titers have been lowest for the inactivated and adenoviral vectors, better for the mRNA vaccines, and highest for the one subunit vaccine that is in phase three, which is by Novavax. Now, and certainly all these vaccines have been undoubtedly very, very important and useful tool for public health. There's been a concern about recent mutant strains, especially from Brazil and South Africa. And for example, the AstraZeneca vaccine rollout in South Africa was halted because of a limited response against the local strain. The good news is that relatively low amounts of neutralizing antibodies are sufficient to protect non-human primates from lung pathology. And even in humans, the titers elicited by natural infection are not that high. And we still need to better understand these so-called correlates of protection. Now, one issue with the current vaccines is they all require refrigeration. And in the case of mRNA vaccines, they require low temperature storage, sometimes very low, minus 70 degrees, for example, prior to administration. So this is a problem in many parts of the world. Okay. So once again, okay. So let me just talk now. This is the Covishield vaccine. This is data from a phase one, phase two trial. And again, neutralizing antibody responses were detected. And but they were relatively low. So these are the neutralizing antibody responses in people with confirmed infection. And this is what was got in the vaccine trials. And this is in healthcare workers, a small number of them. Okay. So this is now the Bharat Biotech Covaxin inactivated virus. Here also, there were neutralizing, this is the ratio of the cytokines which are produced, Th1 to Th2. We will not bother with that for the time being, but it's just an indication that we are getting what's called a Th1 biased response, which is a good property. These are the neutralizing antibody response, and the only thing to note is that A, they persist for some time after vaccination. And secondly, they are similar to what we have in convalescent sera. Okay? That is people who have had infection and have recovered. And the titers persisted to similar levels at least 2 months after the last immunization. All this work has been published. Now, these are the variants, the particular variants of concern. One is in the which is prevalent in the UK and the others in South Africa. And it's very, very difficult once a variant emerges in the human population anywhere to really stop it circulating, other than through vaccination, possibly. The good news is that for the UK variant, at least the convalescent sera from the vaccinees was in convalescent sera as well as sera from vaccines, I should say. These are two different things. In both cases, those sera were still able to neutralize the virus with similar titers as the wild type virus. However, with the South Africa variant, there was a tenfold drop in neutralization titers in convalescent sera. And in fact, many of the convalescent sera, over 50% of them, failed to neutralize the virus. And even in the vaccinees, there was a tenfold drop. So this is a concern, and this is one part of the reason why the Chadoff vaccine rollout was stopped. This is not to say it doesn't have efficacy. I mean, it's still early to say that, but still it was a matter of concern. Okay. So now if we summarize the data from all these different kinds of vaccines, these are the names of the vaccines. I think the important thing that everybody is interested in is this efficacy column. And the efficacy, typically, the way it is measured is the ability to prevent infection within 2 weeks after vaccination. Now, that's a relatively low bar, okay, because ideally you would want the efficacy to be measured over a much longer time scale. But in a clinical trial, we don't have some of those luxuries. So now, if you look at the efficacy estimates, you can see that depending upon the geography, the same vaccine can have very different efficacy. And it goes partly by the way the efficacy is measured. Okay? If we look, for example, at the Oxford AstraZeneca vaccine, in different places, again, it had different vaccines. And the most, if you look at the J&J vaccine, you can see that it was 72% in the US, but only 57% in South Africa. Similarly, the Novavax vaccine, which had an efficacy of over 95% against the wild type virus, had only 60% in South Africa when the clinical trial was done. So these are all, so they're all, of course, having an efficacy anywhere over 50% is valuable. But these are things that are a bit of a matter of concern. So we have also been working in a small way in this area. So instead of taking the whole spike protein, we focused on a small part of the spike, which is called the receptor binding domain. And in the receptor binding domain, what it does is, it, as the name suggests, it binds to the ACE2 receptor and initiates the process of infection. So we made this choice very early on, before many things about the vaccine responses were known. But as it turns out, over 95% of the neutralizing antibody response in vaccinees is directed against the receptor binding domain. So certainly, this is the most important component, it's clear, for a vaccine. This is a fragment of the spike protein. The whole spike protein is about 1,000 to 300 amino acids long. This is just about 200 amino acids long. So we've made versions of this with additional sugars, for reasons I don't have time to discuss, and expressed it in a number of different expression systems, mammalian cells, insect cells, and pichia. And what we showed was this particular protein was very thermotolerant. I'll show you some of the data. And we also showed in an animal model that we could protect against very high doses of the virus in a challenge study. Okay, again, it seems to be okay. So now, this is just a brief characterization. We made the protein in mammalian cells. We looked at the thermal stability, which was about 51 degrees. We showed, using a technique called surface plasmon resonance, that it binds to the ACE2 receptor with nanomolar affinity, as well as to another antibody. Okay. Now, we also made the whole spike protein, and one of my colleagues, Dr. Somnath Datta, did electron microscopy to show that it forms the expected kind of shape. And the spike protein also binds very well to the ACE2 receptor. Now, we also next subjected the protein to freeze drying. And very interestingly, when we looked at the thermal stability before and after freeze drying, it was identical. But more importantly, when we took the protein and dissolved it in buffer and heated it up, okay, it underwent an unfolding transition. And when we cooled it down, it again folded back completely reversibly. So this reversible folding behavior is not such a common attribute of proteins, especially proteins in vaccine formulations. And certainly this was not true for the spike protein. So the full length spike, if you heat it up, it's like heating an egg. Okay, you can't get it back to what it was before you boil it. So not only that, we showed that we could, when the protein was freeze-dried, we could subject it to very high temperature for quite a long time. And when we could store it at 37 degrees for more than a month without any change in its properties. So this is the binding to the ACE2 receptor. And you can see the protein, which was immediately measured at 4 degrees, this trace here, and the lyophilized protein, after being kept at 37 degrees for a month, are basically identical to each other within experimental error. So it's exceptionally thermotolerant. So next we looked at how it performs in terms of immune response, and without bothering you with a lot of details, the what we showed that was when we immunized this in guinea pigs, that we get reasonable titers of antibodies, not outstandingly high, but not too bad. So these numbers are the dilution of the sera, at which the highest dilution at which we can still measure the antibodies. So that means we can dilute the sera 1 in 10,000 and still detect the antibodies. This is the dilution, maximum dilution, which at which we see 50% of blockage of binding of the protein to the ACE2 receptor. And this is the neutralizing titer. Again, so this is on a log scale, and it's a measure of the ability of our anti-sera to inhibit viral infection. So what this means is we can dilute our anti-sera 500-fold roughly, and it will still inhibit viral entry into target cells in cell culture. So this is with our antigen, this is with the whole spike antigen, which is what is used in the modern and the Pfizer vaccines. And here the results were a bit more variable for the spike. When we expressed the protein in Pichia, we didn't see good protective antibodies. Mice also, we got some antibodies, but overall, the data from mice were not quite as good. So anyway, if we compare our neutralizing titer, this is again on the log scale, with a lot of other vaccines, you can see that it does quite well compared to the bulk of the vaccines. It's difficult to compare neutralizing titers because all these different companies use slightly different neutralization assays. So we'll come to how we address that issue. Okay. So next we looked in hamsters, and because hamsters, as it turns out, are a good animal model for infection by the SARS-CoV-2 virus. So if you look at this in this purple color, are the animals which were not challenged with the virus at all. And you can see they're happily eating and putting on weight. So they've increased their body weight by about 4 or 5% in this 4-day period. So the animals were challenged at day zero. And these are the unvaccinated animals. You can see they're rapidly losing weight, and in 4 days, they've lost 5% of their body weight. These are the animals immunized with the spike protein, where there was still quite a bit of body weight loss. And these are with our antigen in blue, where you can see there is they are basically like the unchallenged animals. When you look at how much viral load is present, you can see that in our challenged animals vaccinated, there's no viral load, just like the mock control. And in the other two groups, we have quite a high viral load. These are cytokines. We don't need to discuss these right now. If you look at the gross pathology, these are the healthy, unchallenged animals. These are the animals in our group. And even to people who don't know, too much about lung pathology, you can see that these two groups look considerably worse than these two. Okay. And these are the spleens. The size of the spleen also is some indicator of the infection. So here again, we have a slight increase, but these other two groups clearly have much larger increases in the spleen size. So the immunized animals were well protected from challenge. They showed very little weight loss in lung pathology, and they showed favorable cytokine profiles. Okay. So next we decided also to make an oligomeric RTE, because it's been known from a number of prior work that if you go from a monomer to a dimer or trimer or multimer, you tend to get better immune responses. So we, looking at the structure, we designed what's called an oligomerization domain. And this was a helical oligomerization domain. So we aligned it close to we constructed, a model, a trimer, and looked to see how we should link them with an amino acid linker. And without going into too many of the details, we were able to successfully make a trimeric receptor binding domain and fuse to a non-im. So we don't want antibodies against the trimerization domain itself. So took care of that as well. So now we looked, we characterized it, it formed a clean peak, and we had designed it so that there were disulfides in the which linked the three monomers in the trimer. Okay. So we saw a nice clean trimeric peak. We also saw that this now bound the ACE2 antibody extremely well. It didn't dissociate at all, and it bound another antibody also very well. Just like the monomeric protein, the oligomeric protein was also resistant to the thermal stress, and we could heat it up to high temperature, cool it down. In buffer, we could keep it for several days without any change in its properties. The lyophilized protein was fine at 4 weeks at 37 degrees. Okay. It remained just the same in terms of its antibody binding. And so like the monomeric RBD, the oligomeric RBD was very thermotolerant. When we looked at the immune responses, I won't focus too much on all these things. What I would like to focus on really is the neutralization titer. So we measure these in a neutralization assay. This is in guinea pigs and this is in mice. This is a log scale, so it was a bit more immunogenic in mice. And what we also looked at is the ability to neutralize the virus compared to what is present in what are called convalescent sera. So these four sets of data, this data and this data, were with two different adjuvants. So that's the difference in the data. This data is the in the same neutralization assay, how well the sera were able to neutralize the same virus from human convalescent sera. Okay, so you can see that the human convalescent sera had neutralization titers of about maybe 150 or so, whereas our sera had titers which were in the region of several tens of thousands in the best case. Okay, so we were able to elicit neutralizing antibodies at 30 to 300 fold higher titers than convalescent sera. Okay. So this is our oligomeric RBD. Now I'll just explain this plot. So our designed oligomeric RBD elicits 200 fold higher titers of neutralizing antibodies relative to convalescent sera. And this is much higher than virtually all licensed vaccine formulations. Okay, so the important number to look at is these peach colored numbers here. This is the ratio of the neutralizing titer in mice compared to the neutralization titer in convalescent sera. Okay, and you can see that for the Moderna and the beyond Pfizer vaccines, it's about roughly 5 to 10 fold higher. For the Novavax vaccine, it's about 20 fold higher. And for us, it's about, 200 fold higher. So this is again the ratio of the neutralizing antibody titer in mice compared to the neutralizing antibody titer in human convalescent sera measured in the same study with the same assay. So that's why this ratio is a little bit better number to compare. Okay. So I'll just summarize. There are 11 different vaccines which have been granted approval in different geographies, and with close to 60 in different clinical trials. And the reported efficacies are in the range of about 50 to 90%. So, the vaccines are doing very well. However, there is a concern about these variants, right? Where the both convalescent sera as well as the vaccine sera have decreased efficacy against these variants. Now, our current formulation is quite immunogenic and thermotolerant, and neutralizing titers in the small animals were about 20 to 300 fold higher than in convalescent sera. We made permanent cell lines, and importantly, what we've recently been able to show that our vaccine sera are able to also neutralize in a surrogate assay, not in an actual assay because we don't have the virus yet, but in something similar to a neutralization assay, we are equally well able to neutralize both the wild type as well as the South African mutants. So overall, such kinds of thermotolerant derivatives show great promise to combat COVID-19, and very likely they do not require a cold chain. So I'd just like to acknowledge the people who did all this work. These are the students in my lab at IISc. Sameer was responsible for a lot of the designs and characterization. Shahbaz did a lot of work in yeast to improve the antigens, which I haven't talked about. And everybody, Dr. Somnath Datta did the beautiful EM structures that I showed you. And all these other people contributed to various aspects of the program. Our initial pseudoviral assays were done in collaboration with Professor Stalingrad at ICER Trivandrum. The viral, the full-length authentic virus assays were done by Shailendra Mani at THSTI in Faridabad. And the hamster challenge experiments were done by Dr. Zaigam Rizvi in Dr. Amit's lab at THSTI. The funding for this work has largely come from the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation. And we also received some amount of money from the Prime Minister's Scientific Advisors Office to improve and work out some of the hamster challenge studies. This work has involved a very close collaboration with a startup called Minvax, which I co-founded a few years ago. And they have really been responsible for all the animal immunization studies and a lot of the assays that were done there. The bulk of the pseudoviral assays have been done by Dr. Rajesh Ringe and his colleague at CSIR ImTech. And the human convalescent sera were supplied by Dr. Rajesh Pandey and his collaborators at Max Hospital in Delhi. The initial part of this work was published in JVC. It's got a lot of attention worldwide because, you know, we could show that we had a thermotolerant vaccine candidate. And the oligomer work, a lot of it is out now. It's up in bioarchive for those who are interested. So I will just stop here now, and I'll be happy to take any questions.
Thank you. Very interesting talk and very impressive work. It's a really, really amazing to see the both efficiency and the stability of you. I'm looking at the questions from the participants, and there is a question from YouTube participant, Dr. Rakesh Kumar Mishra. He has asked two questions. One is, what is the similarity with SARS virus?
And between the SARS virus and the SARS-CoV-2 virus? So there is certainly a lot of similarity in many proteins, but in the receptor binding domain in particular, although they both bind the ACE2 receptor, the there are a sufficient number of differences, so that especially in the region of the specific amino acids which bind the receptor, there are some significant differences. So it's, you know, if you were just to take the receptor binding domain from the older SARS virus, it's unlikely that it would be, you know, very efficacious against the present virus. I think there's one question about why there should be two COVID, two doses of the vaccination. So the thing is that our immune system, unless we've been infected, has not really seen this virus. So the first time we receive the immunization, of course, there will be some degree of protective responses which are generated, but they are significantly boosted by a second immunization. Now, it has been seen with the Moderna vaccines as well as with another viral Ad26 vaccine produced by J&J, that there is a significant response after the first dose of the vaccine. Now, our ability to measure immune responses in clinical trials, mostly what we are able to measure are the serum antibody levels. We are not able to have any estimate of the extent of immune memory. So that's also a bit of a limitation of the way in which assays are done and which can be done in the context of a clinical trial. So that's why two immunizations are recommended. So unless we were to do a rigorous clinical trial with a single immunization and compare it with a two-dose thing, it would be a bit difficult to know. So this is the reason why it's safer to take two immunizations, even though there may be some degree of protection after the first immunization.
There is a third question, Agwan. What is the herd immunity, any advantage for the vaccine?
Okay, so herd immunity happens when a significant proportion of the population has either been infected and therefore has acquired immunity to virus, or has acquired vaccine-induced immunity. So in order for a viral infection to propagate through the population, so there have to be a sufficient number of susceptible people. So basically, for the viral infection to propagate, each person on average has to infect more than one person. Because if each person infects less than one person, then the chain of transmission breaks down. So what herd immunity is really is that there are a sufficient number of people who are immune to the virus, so that once the virus infects them, it's a dead end, right? And therefore the infection does not propagate. So that's the reason why it's very important. And herd immunity can be brought about through natural infection, which of course comes at a huge loss of life and livelihood, or it can come through vaccination. And so obviously, it's much better to have it through vaccination. So as for the positive and negative sides, I mean, the positive sides are of course the immune benefit. And the negative side is that in some small number of people, you know, anything is going to have some possible side effects, but the benefits far, far outweigh the negative aspects of the vaccination.
Raghavan, another question is, how is the amount of dosage decided? What parameters are used in arriving at?
Right. So this is also, it's only by trial and error. And so it's decided really on the basis of what are called preclinical studies that are done. Okay. When we do the studies in animals, we can carry out studies at varying doses and then decide on what is likely to be the optimal dose in the clinical trial. Now, in a clinical trial, one can also do it at multiple doses. So for the mRNA vaccines, they were done at multiple doses to decide on what the best dose should be for the trial. So it's a matter of experimentation. And typically, you know, we don't go to doses much beyond, you know, 20 to 100 micrograms or so per person. So again, there's a trade-off between the side effects and the efficacy. So larger doses will probably might have higher antibody responses, but it comes at the cost of side effects.
There is a question from Dr. Vanika Sambarnathan. Does the efficacy of the virus vaccination is affected by the logistics and storage across the world?
Now, when vaccines are licensed, it's implicit that they are licensed for use under certain conditions. And so a vaccine should not be administered if those conditions cannot be met. So, for example, because some of the mRNA vaccines currently have this requirement for very low temperature storage, they're certainly not appropriate for the bulk of the citizens of our country, because we cannot maintain that degree of low temperature storage. So I think more correctly, where a vaccine can be used will be dependent upon its logistics. If the logistics cannot be met, then we should not be using the vaccine in that particular location.
There's one more question which says, the whole world is looking for speedy vaccine invention. What is the tenure of clinical trials in both animals and humans for SARS-CoV-2 vaccine?
The trials, the length of time it takes to develop the vaccine, assuming you have a vaccine candidate, so one has to do the animal studies, which in the best case can take, a month or two. I mean, less than 2 months is difficult to do that. And then there are also all the regulatory processes, which vary a lot from one country to another. And the amount of, different regulators ask for different kinds of things. So, for example, one of the requirements might be that you have to make multiple batches of the vaccine and show that, there's very little batch-to-batch variability. And that can take some time. Once the clinical trials start, the process is relatively straightforward and probably does not vary a lot from one country to another. The problem is that in order to get the efficacy for a vaccine, you need to have, you need to A, do a placebo trial, which means that some proportion of the people have to not get the vaccine, but they have to get a placebo. And B, the prevalence of infection has to be high enough that you see a significant number of infections in the placebo, so that you get a statistically significant difference between the vaccine group and the placebo group. So as more and more people acquire immunity, either by prior infection or vaccination, it becomes more and more difficult to do a proper phase 3 clinical trial. But the quickest way things can be done, as we have seen, with appropriate regulatory and appropriate governmental financial support, has been almost 1 year from the start of the vaccine research to the limited use approval of the vaccine. And this is, of course, extraordinarily short period of time.
What efficacy of vaccine in the Indian context, clinical trial, or is it more risky? I'm interpreting something there.
Yeah, I don't understand. If you want to know what is the efficacy of the vaccine in the Indian context, we do not have the answer yet, because of a complete phase 3 trial of the vaccine has not been done in India for either the Chadox vaccine, the Covishield, or the Covaxin vaccine. However, for the Covishield vaccine, there have been international trials, and you have seen that the efficacy varies a bit from region to region, depending, I expect, most likely on the viral strain. So in South Africa, there was no efficacy because it was not, I think, the trial was not, the rollout was stopped. So we didn't have firm, but the overall efficacy for the Chadox vaccine, I think, was of the order of about 70%. For the inactivated, for the Bharat Biotech vaccine, there have been similar inactivated vaccines in other geographies. And there also the efficacy, reported efficacy, has varied widely from about 50% to, 85% or so. And that, unfortunately, is because A, people use different measures of efficacy. So whether it's against preventing severe disease or preventing mild disease, And you know, it could also be dependent upon what are the strains that are circulating over there. So the short answer is that we don't have an unambiguous number in India, but there's no reason to believe that it would be very different from what is there in other geographies. And so, which would be for both vaccines, I suspect, in the region of about 60 to 70%. But that is protection against any kind of infection. We do not really, for any of the vaccines, have a rigorous idea of the efficacy against preventing severe disease, which is actually, you know, the most important thing. And there, the efficacy is likely to be quite a bit higher.
Yeah. So, Raghavan, I don't think there are any other questions. And I wish to express some thoughts on your talk today, which was absolutely brilliant and very suitable for celebration of the National Science Day, as you really connected all of us with the topic of really greatest correct relevance to society, and also showed how your beautiful basic science research, which is well recognized, as I speak on the slide today, the publication has been really widely seen, also has an impact of translation into a real sort of solution for a societal problem through the startup company that you founded. It's a really appropriate example to give to the society, and also particularly to our government, to impress upon how basic science can be powerful and impact our lives. Thanks very much. Your talk also was very accessible. I think it allowed us to connect with other vaccines and ongoing efforts in the country and elsewhere in the world, and understand the simple technicalities of various issues about the immunity response and vaccination. Really, I'm proud to have you with us today to talk about this very important and nice work and explaining it. Thanks very much on behalf of Indian Academy.
Thanks. Thank you. Thank you so much, Umesh. My pleasure, and I hope it was useful.